Dear aspirants, in this video, let us look at the options available with India to respond to the most barbaric attack by the Chinese troops on Indian soldiers that led to the martyrdom of 20 Indian bravehearts in the eastern Ladakh's Galwan Valley. Well, China is in its pursuit for regional, oblique global dominance, has adopted a two-pronged policy. Ideally, China buys out allegiance of weaker nations as demonstrated through its infrastructure diplomacy being promulgated via its Belt and Road initiative. Examples of such an allegiance in our neighborhood are CPEC in Pakistan, infrastructure investment in Nepal, exploration of natural resources in Myanmar, Hambantota port in Sri Lanka, etc. The larger aim of China is to enslave the country economically through a debt trap. In case of nations that are not readily amenable and stand up to China's might, like India or Vietnam, Indonesia, Philippines, etc., China applies the tactics of intimidation and military dominance. Now let us understand the China's bigger design, which is behind what it did in Ladakh. China has applied the aforesaid protocol that we've just discussed and backstabbed India by, on one side, showing to the world that India is an aggressor that had violated the LAC, while China had to act in self-defense even as the process of disengagement was going on after the core commander level talks. The larger design of China in this barbarously violent standoff appears to be as follows. Firstly, seize the initiative by striking first and unexpectedly, especially at the time when COVID-19 cases in India are rising astronomically. Play the victim card by projecting India as an aggressor who had occupied Chinese territory. Quickly terminate the hostilities before pressure from the global community mounts. Stage forward its defensive line, secure critical passes, dominating tactical features, and create operational opportunities for furthering its subsequent operations. Point in case being that China has occupied dominating heights in Galwan Valley to assume control over Galwan River, interdict Indian military convoy movement for servicing the Daulat Bay Oldi airstrip and the post over there, as also it will give them an opportunity to dominate the Karakoram Pass. In the process, China will also be able to foreclose some of the offensive options that may be presently available to India in this particular area. Consequently, China will be able to bring India to the negotiating table and dictate terms for settlement of the dispute from a position of strength. At the same time, China will be in a position to occupy the moral high ground through its reasonableness and appeal for peace. Lastly, China, through its aggressive stance, intends to deliver a sharp, demonstrative military rap on Indian knuckles and exhibit its regional superiority. Now, we must understand that China is not invincible. China has to understand that India has come a long way from the 1962 debacle. India no longer finds China to be a 10-ton crazy Godzilla, that is what it is made out to be. The People's Liberation Army of China has its own inherent vulnerabilities. Let us look at some of those. Now, there is a lack of battle-hardened troops with China, unlike India, which has been engaged in counter-terrorism operations for decades. The Sino Vietnam War in 1979 was the last military venture in which Vietnam had actually outperformed China. The rapid modernization of PLA has outstretched the institutional ability to adapt to the resultant changes, and it is suspected that the man behind the machine may not be as effective to deliver on the ground. China seriously lacks inter-service integration, essentially required to win a battle, because of its preferential treatment given to its ground forces. Chinese Army has a high teeth-to-tail ratio, with just around 850,000 ranks and files reportedly form part of the combat units. Lastly, the pampered youth as a result of one-child policy in China do not easily take to the hardships of life in the barracks. Hence, the morale and affinity to train is expected to be low. Now, how must India respond to China? China will very closely observe India's political and military resolve, and our response as a nation will decide our future standing in the regional arena. This is no time for unwarranted social media jingoism that may panic the government into taking some kind of a hasty retaliatory action that may cost the nation dearly. The response to Chinese barbarism must be well calibrated to appropriately cover the diplomatic, politico-military and economic domains. Now, at the diplomatic level, India must closely integrate and align with the countries that are hostile to China, like Japan, Vietnam, Indonesia, Philippines, etc., and project a collective front. China is confronted with numerous internal challenges of maintaining political security and social stability that can be exploited by India also. To name a few, the democratization of Taiwan is a serious threat to China, and a separate identity which it is asking for can also be stirred by India by supporting it. Also, a liberal Hong Kong wants political freedom. Tibetans have upped the ante for a free Tibet, and a violent demand of Uyghur Muslims who occupy the Xinjiang province for right to self-determination are some of the examples that are happening internally within China. Now, the political military level, the response could entail the following. Now, it is important that the political will of the country is demonstrated, and a clear signal from India must go that India will not bow down to the aggressive designs of China. Now, the rules of engagement must be clearly spelled out to the troops deployed on the ground. They have to be extremely vigilant and wary of the Chinese. Every movement on ground and every activity that they undertake must be done tactically. Militarily, we must maintain a more assertive and forceful stance in projecting our footprints. At the tactical level, renewed emphasis must be laid on patrolling and surveillance using satellites, unmanned aerial vehicles, and battlefield surveillance radars. Moreover, India needs to improve its force level along the LAC and northeastern border with China, besides going on an overdrive to improve the infrastructure and connectivity in these areas for quick mobilization of its forces. Deployment of strategic assets, keeping the threat perception in mind, will serve as a serious deterrent and a threat in being, for example, the deployment of Agni 5. Now, at the economic level, there is a lot that can be done. India must go for an all-out economic war against China, which seriously hurts it, even if it amounts to bearing the pain ourselves. India imports goods worth 5.25 lakh crores from China, though it amounts to only 2% of overall exports of China. Still, the trade deficit, as India imports much more than it exports to China, is $57 billion out of the total $422 billion that Chinese enjoy globally as a trade deficit. So in other words, by allowing such a huge trade surplus to China, we are literally financing China to harm us. It is understood that boycott of Chinese goods will hurt Indian consumers, as the products are comparatively much cheaper and we may lose millions of jobs in logistics and trades that involve dispensing of these products. However, no one in this world is really indispensable. We can look at other countries like South Korea, Japan, Taiwan, even US, Europe, etc. for import of such products. By boycotting Chinese products, the domestic cost of products may rise in the short run, but the same will also prompt local production and importing from other destinations. The Confederation of All India Traders has called for a boycott of Chinese goods by releasing a total of 450 broad categories of commodities which cover over 3,000 Chinese products, and the trade body has said that its objective is to reduce the import of Chinese finished goods by rupees 1 lakh crore by December 2021. Now lastly, the effort to boycott Chinese goods has to become a mass movement in India to become successful, which must be followed by imposing heavy tariffs and ban on Chinese technologies by Government of India to be able to deliver the desired economic blow to China. So these are some of the actions that India could take at various levels to give a befitting reply to China, as also at the border, India must stand strong and the nation must stand behind the soldiers who are fighting the cowardly Chinese at the LAC. Thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed the video.